collectively, they're a set of problems, right? There aren't as many problems if there aren't historic buildings, right? There's huge numbers that go away, huge complexities that choke parts of the site and make it harder to pull on. But that's not the reality. The reality is the people of the town of Portland, as I've listened to them, care deeply about the historic structures. And therefore, something to build around. And frankly, I'm not a guy who has any big problem with that. I'm excited about the Brainerd House. I get less excited if you go down the list of the other structures than just candidly, but it is something that I think will be exquisite when done. And so I just look at it from the standpoint of how do you get it done if you all want to do it together? If you can't get the collective will to do it, then it doesn't happen, regardless of any individual's objective, you know, wants. It won't happen, no matter what I want, if I don't have your guys' support. It just can't.
If I could just return to my question, and I think it's obvious, but these properties, these historic properties that you're talking about, have deteriorated over the last 10 years under Mr. Hassan's stewardship. Is that correct?
They've deteriorated for a long time,
yeah.
In terms of how they were even fit up in the inside, when it was an operating property, probably. However, what I would say is that these were buildings on the site that were only recently designated as historically significant. That was something after the 2009 approval. And if we get into a more complex analysis about historic structures, it comes down to reasonableness. The law of the land is this: for reasonable steps taken to preserve structures, that's what keeps them intact. If there's not a reasonable scenario for moving forward, they can go away. They can deteriorate in place. They can do all kinds of things. And it's not a threat or anything else. It's just this statement of fact and how there are lots and lots and lots of poorly maintained buildings that have been around a long time in the state of Connecticut and everywhere else.
So you're asking the taxpayers essentially to foot the bill and bail this out and take care of these historic properties under Mr. Hassan's stewardship that have just deteriorated and become more and more blighted. And you're suggesting that that might continue in the future. So I just find it hard that the taxpayers of the town of Portland are gonna step in and bail out someone for their responsibility. He owns the piece of the properties, he owns them, he should take care of them. It's just that simple. Sure.
Fred.
Town officials, town community, various committees, we entered into a partnership to develop this property according to the town's plan of development and conservation. It was a partnership. So my question to you, Mr. Flood, what is the town contributing to this partnership?
Do you want to pay profit to the town over the next 100 years or so out of the rent that you're receiving?
I will be paying profit.
You would like to
I
do that? So maybe we can negotiate that.
I will be paying. You want to make a deal, we'll split the profits, we'll split the cost. Do it.
This is still America. It's a private piece of property. It's your obligation. You want to go into business and develop it, you do it. It's just that simple.
We entered into a partnership. Countless meetings with various committee members, town members, right? We had a partnership.
That word frightens me when you talk about it in those terms. But the partnership, the deal did not include getting a tax abatement for 7 years. That's why we're talking about it this evening.
And I could point out what the town gave.
Include that.
I'm sorry?
We certainly thought it included that in February of 2015.
Like I said earlier, I can't imagine how.
I can point out what the town has given. We changed our regulations.
Shall we make sure that Ryan finished?
Yes.
And then
I'll wrap this up. Philosophically, I have problems with this, really, because what you're asking the town to do is to interfere with the market, quite honestly. You're asking the town, the government, to put their thumb on the scales, and it's not going to make it fair to other people playing in the market. There are other people who rent properties here, and you're getting a tax subsidy as a result, and it changes the market. There are other pharmacies in town, and you're changing the marketplace with the tax subsidy, and it's not fair. There are other supermarkets in the area, and I don't know what else is going in there. But if the town is changing the dynamics of this, and we're putting our thumb on the scale to make it easier for you to make a living, it makes it harder for somebody else to make a living. And then the next thing you know, that business is getting boarded up, closed down, because you're getting the benefit for 7 years. And then in 7 years, what happens, right? Your tile, your it's now old. It's not really, you know, what someone's interested in buying. It just changes things. The numbers that you're talking about, I don't think are accurate. They're all based on a $2,500 rent. If you don't get a $2,500 rent, the taxes are going to be a lot less.
How are you coming to that?
Because
$2,500 had nothing to do with rent. That was the tax bill to the town per unit. It had nothing to do with.
Are the taxes based on how much revenue you're earning? Aren't there different models that the town uses based on?
Of course,
right? Correct.
You were alluding to
Fair
a presentation.
Enough.
I just wanted to clarify what the presentation.
I don't know that I was alluding to that.
Your
rent is what, $2,500? Is that right? Is that what you're suggesting?
No. There's a net unit mix that takes it down, so it's below 2,000 as an average across a different an array of units from studios to one bedrooms.
What's the range? I thought I heard you mention $2,500.
$1,150 to on the highest side.
Sure. That's the number you mentioned this evening, I believe.
No?
Okay.
But that's okay.
Sure.
Because we can dialogue it out.
Sure.
We can at least get the facts
sure.
on the table and,
sure.
and then go from there. And we can get locked in philosophical differences. And that's to your free country side of things. It's very free.
Sure.
And so we can all go about our days doing whatever makes sense. I think that there's actually what I have found. Folks who have spent the most time in the trenches and kind of dialoguing this out, the stakeholder group, wide array of backgrounds, and the folks who have been most at the front seat of the conversations, I think, are very supportive. And so I think that that's at least worth considering as a representative
sure.
of the town, that there are people from very, very different backgrounds who believe that the development proposal is appropriate. And it's not taking away from anyone. In fact, it's actually contributing to the town's collective goals.
I understand that I'm sitting here in a representative capacity, but I kind of read the tea leaves a little bit differently, I suppose. So.
No. It's good to have a dialogue.
Sure.
Frankly,
anything else, Brian?
Nope.
Ben?
I guess I'm going to be all over the place here. So. First, I don't believe you to be the bad guy. So you mentioned that earlier. I don't look.
Neither do I, by the way.
Yeah. And you know what? I know you're doing your job. And part of my capacity up here is for me to do my job. And I believe I was, as being part of this board, I have to look at this as, is it a good financial decision to give out any tax abatement, whether it's you or the next guy? This is, to me, I'll look at each one and with an open mind, and I will go through the facts and then make a decision based on the facts. There's been a lot of talk about historic preservation. This isn't the meeting for that, in my opinion. In my opinion, this is a discussion on whether a tax abatement for 238 apartments or 240, whatever number you come in with, and all of the commercial side of it is a good idea for the residents of the town of Portland or not. I think the reality is I would have a much better comfort level knowing exactly what you were going to build. And I would, at least in previous applications, I think it was a requirement to literally have a dollar amount of what the assessment would be when it was finalized, and you would have to agree to that dollar amount, and you would have to agree not to appeal it, which I wasn't even sure was legal. But those were what happened in the past. on previous tax abatements. The reality is, on the past three tax abatements, none of them were residential. I too, like other board members have mentioned, I have a serious concern when you're talking about a tax abatement on a residential unit, regardless of whether it's a mix or not. I think it sends the wrong message to the residents of Portland who do pay their taxes and do contribute to the community. I think the reality is, the other tax abatements, all three of them, did not impact existing businesses. One tax abatement was for a golf shop, one tax abatement was for an environmental slash construction company, and one tax abatement was for a marijuana facility. All good businesses, they all deserve their tax abatements. It didn't impact other businesses. The reality is, it didn't add anybody to the school systems. It didn't increase the burden to the public school system in any way, which we all have discussed in previous meetings is a big burden to the town. So residentially, I have a big problem. On the commercial end, I would want to know exactly what we're getting. For example, if one of the components is a pharmacy or even a restaurant that you mentioned and a coffee shop, I would want to really get into all the numbers and figure out, is that a good idea? Is it good to give a tax abatement to a pharmacy that is then going to impact the pharmacy down the street and essentially give your pharmacy the upper hand? I don't believe that's what tax abatements were created for. I think they were created to stimulate the economy where it was needed. For example, we don't have a brewery in Portland. I would say, okay, you want to put in a brewery? You may get a tax abatement. I'm giving you my philosophy on this. The reality is, all of the existing tax abatements, at least the three that I'm aware of, once again, were not residential and did not impact other businesses. And I think that's very important when deciding whether a tax abatement is appropriate. In your numbers tonight, you mentioned, I think it was $2 million in increased revenue. Did that $2 million encompass water and sewer fees during that time frame?
Yes.
I would argue they need to be taken out. It's a utility. The reality, and who knows what happens in the future, we may not even own our utility. You never know what happens. The reality is, those fees, there's a direct cost involved. So, and I believe the number was $580,000 you had in your chart up here. $580,000, well, I would argue, well, we're losing money, so it costs at least the $580,000. There's no revenue. The other, you had a number up there of
$250,000. Then will you tell me, and I can
comment on this? Oh, hang on, I'll take a pause and let you, yeah, please. So okay, that way we're
going to. No, just because I don't want to.
Right. No, no, no.
I'm throwing up a list.
No, I'm throwing so much at you. I would rather I pause and give you an opportunity to rebut those.
Okay, well, and it's just to kind of the object in motion slide, right, where there are fixed costs, and when you're running a town that has had to put the money out to provide any level of service to the residents, right? So you are already sitting talking about the sewer and water losing money, and you're talking about no new investment going into that situation, it's real today, right now, then why are we ignoring new revenue that doesn't come with associated costs, operating costs? Why is that not worth at least considering as a board that no one else that I'm aware of is saying, I'll buy $500,000 worth of sewer and water, right, with no incremental investment. Why is that not part of the consideration?
Well, the reality is, we haven't seen, will that put us over the threshold? We're already aware of, will that put us over the threshold of actually being able to serve people? We've already, there's reports that show we have millions and millions of dollars in repairs needed. Could this put us over the threshold?
Well, I know you.
One at a time.
My only point is this, because I haven't done studies of your infrastructure, and so I can say this, that if I have $1 million problem, somebody comes up to me with $500,000. That's welcome input. I don't say, well, I still have $500,000 problem. I'm happy to have gotten my problem cut in half. And so my only point in putting it before the selectmen is to say, these are incremental processes that frankly, you know, I was up here talking about everything. The last meeting I was saying, you and I were lamenting the fireworks situation.
Yep.
This is stuff.
Just to finalize the water and sewer, the reality is this board has been discussing possibly getting rid of it. So I do not want to consider it when we may not even own it in a short amount of time.
Well, if I could interject, Ben, it's important to point out that with about 2,400 water customers and 1,700 or so sewer customers, and I'm looking at a water and sewer commission member out here, it's not easy to be able to do the kinds of improvements that we would need to make and that we would like to make. And as we contemplate the potential of another entity either taking over the water and sewer, or we contemplate another method of providing that service, perhaps as a member of a larger entity, there are economies of scale that do occur, and there is an attractiveness that a particular customer, if it's the town, would be if there were more customers than when there were less. So I'm not going to comment on how that would affect a sale. I can tell you that revenue is most necessary to run quality water and sewer. I just wanted to interject.
We've sold utilities before, and I would affirm that statement.
Yeah,
it's attractive to the buyer.
And the reality is whatever you do on the site, I would imagine, is going to use city water and city sewer. My point was, I don't believe that number should be in the $2 million. I do not believe wholeheartedly, and I'd like the response on this one, the $250,000 in permitting, that will get spent. Once again.
That's where, if we could get over the threshold of ping pong of it all, right, we could have a dialogue about how to address liability and defer the assumption in your statement that it will get spent. You can have peer reviews that are the obligation of the applicant. There are many ways of mitigating risk that get the cost off of your books, but are still, revenue. All I'm saying is,
I would argue if you were going to do that, we wouldn't take the fees. That isn't set up to be a profit. We've gone over this in past meetings. Planning and zoning permit fees are not designed to be a profit for the town. They're designed to be a service that we provide for the community, and if you want to build and you're willing to take on all of that, your fee should be lowered. I want to be clear. The reality is that's a pass-through, and if we are generating money, and I've discussed this in the past, and as the chairman of the ZBA, we've had to increase our fees because we were losing money. Former chairman, sorry. That's true. Wow. The reality is, I've been on boards a long time, 8 years or 7 or 8 years on Board of Ed and 11 or 12 on ZBA and now here. But the reality is those are not designed and should not be designed to profit. So in other words, your 250 number, the reality is we should be spending the 250. If we think we're making $100,000 off your 250, I will fight to lower our fees because that is not what those are designed for.
Someone watching out for the schools and coming around, making sure that So you have a lot of variability in this, and the art of it is really running it intelligently, so that you are doing, your point about equity.
I think we agree with each other, you're just, yeah.
Yeah, if I could interject, Ben, and I think you know this, okay, you know, in terms of this kind of an application, it would require additional work, as you well stated, and I agree with you. In terms of the fees, they are revisited frequently by this board. They haven't been raised in quite a while. I think Brian and Fred will attest to that. So it is something we keep a close watch on, but this kind of an application would require more than town staff. So if you want to move on
to
the next question.
Yeah, I'm moving on to another subject. I think, first of all, I think it's very important that we actually have an approved site plan from the Planning and Zoning Commission, because I do believe they have the ultimate say on what's going to go on here with the historic preservation, with what you're going to be required to do. I'm under the assumption that they have enough teeth in their text amendment that they just passed to require you to do whatever they feel is appropriate. That's their board, that's their decision.
It's our application.
Yeah.
Our language.
I like your, by the way,
so
good language.
It seems that we can all work together.
Yeah, good language. So it'll be interesting to see the application. Things like the parking garage, for example. I read the state statute a few times that gives us the ability, and we adopted our own policy. I don't believe the parking garage could even be abated, unless it's in conjunction with a mass transit, is how it's worded. So.
Well, we did look at mixed-use development, which is in the policy.
Correct, but never mentions parking garage as far as what our policy, as far as.
It's something we can look into, sure.
And we'd be happy to supply.
Definitely, Ben.
And the reality is, I think, without an approved site plan, using your own words, I wrote it down, this will be very close to the real plan. The reality is, I'm not comfortable with that. I'm going to need a full plan. I'm going to need who the tenants are, because of everything I've mentioned. I believe when you take on this role of the Board of Selectmen, as we sit here, we have to decide what is a good financial decision for the town of Portland and whether a tax abatement is appropriate or not. And the reality is, without all the information, I don't know how anybody up here could make that decision.
Well, you're an expert on one of the abatements that was granted, as you disclosed earlier in the evening. And what I would argue is that there's a disconnect. Saying that things that need to be known to take action are even, you're implying it's even possible on a job of this scale to answer those questions, and it never will. And so what you have, because you're saying first a site plan, which is now the onus is on us to make a much larger investment when we're building on quicksand. And you're further going past it to say you need the actual tenants per space, which is just so far outside reality or scale.
Well, there's even a step further what this commission has done in the past. We're going to want you to agree to an actual dollar amount and then get you to agree not to appeal that dollar amount. There's many layers to this.
Yeah, no, and I think that here's the concept. Is that when this is a collaborative exercise and people are working together, you distill it down to the gotta-haves. It's why there's language in there about a 94,000 square foot scenario and a 75,000 square foot scenario. 75,000 is the lowest possible deliverable to get 16 addition to the site plan, but there'll be at least $20 million spent. The threshold for the state on the 7-year deferral is free, right? We're talking multiples and multiples and multiples of investment beyond, and when we're talking about not having skin in the game, you know, you can't build projects and get a construction loan without pledging assets for the entire spend, okay? So you have your equity that goes into the job, and then you got other things pledged to the entire deal. So you're out on the $40, $50 million levels of exposure. The tax agreement becomes a trivial little thing in the background when you have that kind of liability. You do it because that's the business, and there's something that can be derived that's good from it at the end of the day. Be that it's addressing the town's concerns, it's not gonna kill you, right, if you have some disruption in the economy. There are a lot of things that go into this decision matrix. So when I'm not looking to make this so broad and big, but I am trying to say that if you look at this from another perspective, and when I'm asked, and I was interviewed in the last 6 months on tax evasions in general, why they're good, you will find that if I ever cross over the table and become a public servant, I'm working over developers, like this process, I have a very simple approach. Get them spending money, okay? Because once you get in the game and you're now stuck, in downtown Danbury, we have this tax abatement that I referred to, built a 115-unit building, and there was this horrible blighted thing across the street, okay? And I'd call the mayor and I'd say, this is a disaster. We can't lease up over here because this property, all the tenants have moved out. People who own it won't fix it. It's gone into probate court. It's a disaster. And they say, well, you know, we're kind of working on our latest blight ordinance, and I'm trying to lease a building, right? What happened? I'll tell you. We made the first investment. It was $25 million, okay, in the first building. And we ended up having to make another $3 million investment in this crap-ass little building next door because it was hurting us and we had to protect that asset. The reality of the situation is, if I'm the chairs on the other side of that table, you just want a capable partner who starts spending money, and then all of a sudden all kinds of other things that come up along the way get fixed because smart, capable people are actually working together towards things. If there's this standoff on the front side where you can't even get out of the gates and nothing happens, move on to the next town and you move on to other things, and that's fine. I mean, there's no right or wrong in any of this.
Right. I would say we've definitely made it out of the gates. We've changed our zoning regulations to allow up to 240 non-deed restricted apartments on one site. I would say we have brought a lot to the table.
I would say you had nothing to do with it in any positive way because you were out there fighting it at every turn. So
I was out there hang on for the record.
One
hang
at
on.
A time.
Yeah.
Ben.
Yeah, thank you, Susan. Thank you.
Ben's turn.
Yeah, for the record, I wasn't fighting it, and I want to point out a few things. What I was doing was pointing out there was zero teeth in what the Planning and Zoning Commission approved, and I think you're aware of it. The reality is, hang on.
Yep, this is the application.
Yeah. But I just want to point out some facts here.
Okay.
The reality is the Planning and Zoning Commission, the text amendment that they just approved and they feel comfortable with, mentions historic preservation of something of significance listed in the plan of conservation development. It doesn't even say you are required to fix a building. It just says it has to be something exactly what I just said. So the reality is, there is no teeth in what they passed, and if you, earlier you admit you wrote it, well, good for you. Yeah, good for you. You did an excellent job on writing what you needed. And the reality is, when you have to sit up here and say, I'm going to only be able to give these amenities to the historic buildings based on a tax abatement, you know what that tells me? And it's very clear. It tells me that the Planning and Zoning Commission has no teeth in what they passed. The reality is, they dropped the ball, and people like me were not fighting the process. They were pointing out errors and problems with the text amendment from the other side, not your side. Your side, you did great. There are no errors and there are no problems. You did a wonderful job. You got what you needed. The reality is, and I think your quote in the River East was, without the tax abatement, the historic structures may not be saved. Because the reality is, had the text amendment had enough teeth, you wouldn't be able to say that. So back to here we are tonight. This board is to decide, hang on, let me finish. This board is to decide whether it's a good financial decision or not for the taxpayers of Portland to give a tax abatement when the town of Portland as a whole, and that's where I was referring, when the town of Portland as a whole changed its regulation to allow 240 apartments on one site based on historic preservation of something of significance in the plan of conservation and development. They were satisfied. That was their job to decide what teeth, where they wanted to go with historic preservation. This commission, its sole responsibility, in my opinion, is to decide whether this is a good financial decision for the taxpayers of Portland. So number one, back to, I don't believe a residential abatement is a good idea for the town of Portland, number one. Number two, I believe we would need all of the information to decide whether a commercial or an industrial tax abatement would be a good idea for the residents of Portland. So without a full comprehensive site plan right down to the values, and I think the reality is you would have to then agree to it like in previous ones, the values, and then agree not to appeal during the duration of it. That was another condition that we've used in the past. That's where we stand as this board. So I just want to make sure we're not clouding it. You don't need to say that we haven't brought anything to the table. This town has done a lot of changes to accommodate this site. I believe the town of Portland as a whole has done a tremendous job to move forward with getting Elmcrest developed by allowing 240 apartments on one site when I do believe our largest freestanding single building non-deed restricted is 8 units in the town of Portland. So that's a big change for this little town.
I just want to know if we want to be here till midnight, because okay. We do have other business.
I don't
want
to be here till midnight.
Okay, I just want consensus
from
the
board.
But seriously, Ben, I do want to get consensus from the board, because it is 9:30, and I will continue. I don't have a problem, but I want to make sure the rest of the board is okay. Okay.
Well, I would appreciate a minute or two also.
Yes, yes. So, Ben, it's
when my good friend is finished here.
Again, there's a perception reality, right? Shake hands on the deal. And there's a perception, but there's not yet the binding reality on many levels of agreement, right? We all hope for the old days when you could look a guy in the eye, shake a hand, and it'd be done. But then it seems to have to follow attorneys and write up stuff, and then it's done. And so I understand that it's a two-step process. We just thought we'd take the idea of saying what amounts to over half in value creation in dollars, right, is now doesn't have a tax agreement with it, but then we should still take and bring these historic buildings back, and I'd say what we can, right? And so the idea is that there's a dialogue. Talk about 240 units. We put in the cap. I thought that was what was appropriate. I've been doing this long enough to know what is a little too much and what would really fit in nicely and all that type of stuff. And it's very subjective, I understand that. I also know that you could lay out 600 units of affordable housing on this job without even thinking about it. And the fact of the matter is that you're then having a ping pong match over reasonableness for these historic structures. And who's the better person out there? The affordable housing developer or the historic preservationist?
Could I ask you a question on the affordable housing? Because you brought it up a few times and said
they've...
No, hang on. I just want to ask it. Yeah. Sure, but you're...
We're talking about the laws of the land.
Yeah, no. And
free
I
country.
And I appreciate you bringing it up, and I think you'll like our dialogue.
Good.
The reality is this is probably a valuable site. Do you think a Section 8 housing or affordable housing site is going to buy a high-value site or a low-value site in order to get their, you just threw out 600 units. For example, would you buy another property that's not on a great intersection that would potentially be expensive? Or would you go and buy somewhere else that has city water, city sewer, and do it there for, say, 10% of the land cost? What would you do as a developer? Would you spend 10% or 100% if those were the two? Let's just, I'd like your opinion on that. No, it was land costs. Would you buy an expensive site or a cheap site to start the game?
Avalon Bay is thought of as a luxury apartment developer, and they did more 8-30 jobs. And it was mostly in Lower Fairfield County where they got their 1% of affordable product, and they just butted heads and jammed some stuff through. It doesn't have to be a bad thing, but it's a god-awful process, and towns hate it, okay? Because the local regulations are all set aside.
Yeah.
The state's level stuff supersedes all. And to your point, this is a very good 8-30G site. There's no two ways about it. And that's candidly.
And that's what I wanted. That's what I wanted you to put on the record tonight. You say it like it was a threat earlier. That's how I took it. And
nice.
I wanted to be crystal clear. And I'm glad because I did also read
no
eight. I did also read 830G, and you were right. And the reality is, it shouldn't be used as a threat. And I think it was used as a threat. In the past, in many meetings, and you mentioned it a few times, and I can't think of any other reason why you would mention it other than, who cares? It's another option on the table, and if that's a reality, that's a reality. But that's not what's in front of us tonight. That's not what you're proposing. So I just find it interesting that you keep bringing that up and you keep alluding to it.
I'm going
to
tell you exactly why I'm bringing it up. Because as a board, both in the Zoning Commission and as a board of selectmen, aren't getting a lot of applications that expose members to the option set. If you take my high-minded comment that I didn't make clearly, and I apologize.
Many times I am high-minded, so
what's
it's
that?
Okay. I am high-minded.
I wasn't commenting on your high-mindedness. So I'm with you.
Yeah.
It's all good, because this is a good debate. We should be having an open discussion, because frankly, that's the spirit in which I bring it up. I look at, and I have an inside shot at Fred's world, okay? I know that Fred's not the youngest guy in the room, okay? I know what the other guys after Fred, it's all dollars and cents in my view. Fred is representing the doctors in his mind, having worked with these guys. saying, this is the right thing for the town. I've never had someone looking to sell a property do what he's done, going around and meeting with people and having so much interaction to try to do it right. And so he's not trying to pay the highest and best from a dollars and cents perspective. I can testify to that. And I'm trying to make it very clear. You say it's a threat. I say, I have absolutely no interest in developing under 8-30G. I stepped off early in my career and did a job in Middlebury. We bought it, and we went to the state Supreme Court twice. I learned some valuable lessons.
I read that case, yeah, by the way.
But my point is this. When I'm talking about it, you got to know the level of frustration from the owner's perspective, who has rights, and from the standpoint of my sitting here saying, I don't know why this isn't a compelling pitch, because frankly, I think we actually hit every material point that came up in the dialogue that was the BCI. And I didn't see it at the BCI meeting, Ben, but maybe I just didn't recognize it because I didn't.
No, but it's important to point out, you mentioned the VCI report. It was very clear in the VCI report, no dense housing. That was what the residents of Portland wanted. Page 11.
There's a word cloud that was taken so out of context. This is a quote in the Bible. The point that is, if you actually read and look at the development proposals, they had 240, an option that was 240 units.
Correct, but that doesn't mean the residents voted that they didn't like that. That's how I interpreted the Bible. I love it.
And everyone can agree with you that the brewery would be awesome. Okay.
And I think it would be appropriate for a taxpayer.
It would be a nice pit stop for big water
and come up. And they're a big water user. Susan pointed that out.
So that's good stuff. I mean, I think that the idea is you try to iterate through this to find the common ground. Unfortunately, I didn't understand necessarily the environment I was in when I thought, okay, I'm building a model around a 7-year abatement. And I'm then saying, we can do this, and we can do that, and we can do this, and we can take on these things that I'm now visualizing it and saying, this would be cool.
And in all fairness, you're probably not looking at the same board that you were looking at when you applied to that. So I get that, and I get the fact that the game may have changed a little bit. There's different players.
It may have ended. I mean,
not necessarily. The reality is,
but we can't divorce ourselves from economics. And when you say, well, let's just forget about those millions
of
dollars.
Do you agree?
And you still do all these things that, frankly, I've conceded different things at each step, but I always had something. Like, the only way that we just went on the record with Hart Jarvis was saying, all right, let's take a shot at supersizing that A building. And if it doesn't work out, we're just out the move cost of that, and that's just tough nuggets. I mean, we have to deal with that. But we're making a gesture to try to get movement because, frankly, to me, it's then clarifying. Okay, if with this extra step, the town still doesn't want to see anything move forward here, and I can go on in good conscience, Fred can do what he needs to in good conscience, and you can call it a threat, or you can call it a listing of available options in the free world that we all enjoy.
I like the second one, but the reality is the original proposal was for about 150,000 square feet and had 84 approximate units. Your new proposal is, well, proposed proposal is 94,000 square feet of commercial, and you didn't give an exact number tonight on the residential. Is it 238 or is it 240? I'm assuming.
On the site plan that was submitted to you is 238.
Okay.
And on the language for an associated agreement, we said not to exceed 240, and it's in the zoning regulation not to exceed 240.
Right. So back to my point. My point was, to make it viable in the beginning, they claimed they needed the 84. Because I sat through this whole process when they changed when they created the mud zone. That's how far back I go on this.
Yeah, that predates
you. And the reality is they needed 84 units to create 150,000 square feet of commercial space to make it financially viable. The new proposed proposal, is 94,000 with 238 residential. Well, quick numbers, it would be less than 160 using the same math as before. As far as the ratio of residential units required for to make it financially viable, if you were using the same ratio, and I know you're going to now throw out, well, hang on, you're now going to throw out well, we're restoring some historic structures and this and that. And the reality is, that is why the Planning and Zoning Commission, and they quoted the VCI report, that is why they changed their regulation to allow 240 if you save the buildings that they're going to require you. And the other problem without a specific site plan is, why are we not even discussing the other three historic structures that were on the that are on the registry? The reality is, we keep discussing this site as a six, as three historic structures, when I do believe there's six on the registry.
Yeah, that came up at our very first meeting, and I said, if it's six buildings, I'm leaving.
Well,
now.
And the reality is.
And here's the thing. There was a state level grant given and a directive to those folks to preserve three. Where that prioritization is coming from, the process of it all, is probably a big waste of time to spend time on, because frankly, I've looked at this enough. There was something, someone came up and when we did our little clinic on how to creatively restore buildings, right? Our symposium, the landscape architects that came to Portland, that I agreed to talk at 9 months prior to, because I figured, and no universe could this not be resolved by then. Instead, we made a presentation of the stuff we're working on, right? The things we talked about were, how have we creatively taken down the historic restoration? Because all these people are out there trying to do beautiful things, and they're wondering, how on earth did that Elmcrest site move forward? Now, somebody walks along on that site, and they say, well, geez, the carriage house off the Brainerd House is just lovely. Why isn't that part of it? And I said, well, it seems like the next stop on the bus is the Hard Harvest House. And that seems to be from a wide open conversation with everybody, the next priority. But it can't be everything. There's all of us kind of sitting in here in the gas chamber that is Connecticut. And Elizabeth, you can quote me on that. As it relates to development potential in a zero growth environment, you have to do things differently. You can't say, let's just sit and wait for all these tenants to come banging on the door. We have something that's attractive about this is, we have projected declining enrollment in the schools, okay? We have.
But we fix that problem by bringing in children through another system. Our declining enrollment is offset by the number of open choice children we bring in.
I think we should look at the statistics.
Yeah.
We need to
at least when I was on the board.
It's mitigated. Yeah. I don't know if it's fully addressed.
We're supposed to lose 10. The study shows we're supposed to lose 10 pupils per year, and we were bringing in more than 10 pupils per year in the open choice program as an average.
I do want to leave enough time
it.
For Fred to speak.
And
it's
I'll
10.
Right. I'll finish up.
But then we can continue. This is not the end.
Yeah, I'll finish up.
This is not the end.
I'll finish up. The reality is, I get why you put everything on the table and why you have a process in your mind that needs to be followed. The reality is, it probably doesn't match this small town. This small town needs to have a site plan approved, needs to know exactly what it's getting, needs to know the exact dollar amount of every structure in order to make a good financial decision. And I think you can respect that.
And then by any tea leaf reading would then say no. And so who in their right mind would go through that additional process to come back to
the Chris Cody Golf Shop, the marijuana facility, and Red Technology, were, I would argue, were probably all in their right mind, and they did the process that way.
With all due respect,
I'm not sure about Red Technologies, just for the record.
What about them?
Not familiar with. When was that abatement?
You had it in your little, did you bring it tonight? You don't have it with you?
This board did not approve that. Do you remember that?
That large?
No. I just want to be careful what you say. Let's check it out. Just be careful.
Okay.
I don't want you to be quoted, in other words, until we make sure that.
And if you talked about the total investment made in the town across those two or three deals, what's your dollar amount of new investment?
100% no children in the school system. So in other words, let me answer you. The reality is that number's irrelevant, and I'll tell you why. The reality is it doesn't put the burden on the town of Portland as a residential development would.
And to me, there's a lack of alignment among us for our even making the case on why the design of apartments, when they say 84 units leased and 6 school-aged children, and that's just ignored, right? Then the climate's not right to work together. If there's, tell me more, because if you extend that out over, times 3, that's 18 kids. And how expensive is that with the infrastructure that's in place? Not very, and you can make a very, very, very strong case in why the town is materially better off for this investment being made, because we're not talking ones and twos here. We're talking tens of millions of dollars going into something that could change the presentation of the town. And there are intangibles around the corner associated with this kind of development that actually leads to other people risk-taking and making improvements, because this is not a zero-sum game. This is something where we act as a catalytic developer that spurs other things. We come in early often, and you can go check our past and see the other investments that have been made around it that are very substantial.
And I'll finalize with this. The reality is the numbers you just quoted tonight were not based on the Portland population pupil per residential unit. Portland is 0.31 children per housing unit. The numbers you're using are based on a development you did in another town. And I would point out, in the other towns, they do not have 2 public Blue Ribbon Award. Portland does, which I'm proud of. We're a great town. We have a great school system. The reality is all the numbers you've just spoken about, your 6, and then times it by 3, come out to 18, are not based on Portland, Connecticut. We are sitting here tonight deciding whether this is a good tax abatement for the residents of Portland. And the reality is what you're telling us is based on information from another town on another project, not using the Portland numbers. The Portland number is 0.31 children per housing unit. That's the number that you should use, even though you have different dynamics of bedrooms. I get it.
It's 10 of 10. Yep, I'm going to move on to Fred. Susan. That's it. Fred, you're next.
Fred, ask me a question while you answer that, John.
I'm really impressed with the audience and their persistence and patience here. Good evening, or is it good morning? I'm not quite sure.
But hello.
A couple of things, and as the discussion, I started off with nothing on my sheet, and as the discussion went along, I started making more notes. But I'll be brief. One thing is that clearly, I look at it from the perspective of the site. The site's been there so far, other than the taxes, which Fred has paid, and I commend him. We've got a whole lot of nothing there. Nothing's happened, a whole lot of nothing. So when there's a viable project, I feel committed to looking at it rather carefully. And I realize that our position now is just on the abatement part, the tax abatement. And I think that's something that internally we have to discuss. That's the board doesn't have all of its, components in place in terms of what should or shouldn't be in the abatement. But things like, for example, you were mentioning, Ben, that we have an abatement, tax abatement policy, which is in effect, and it's been used, and I happen to agree with tax abatement policy. I'm a proponent. But I don't think we can pick and choose. You were mentioning, if you have a tax abatement and it's going to be based on new construction, we can't say, okay, Fred, your shoe shop is okay, but Ben, your shirt shop is not okay because there's another shirt shop. I can't see how that kind of an abatement policy. It has to be all or nothing. Either you have a policy or you don't. You can't be concerned about, we're concerned about other businesses who are in town, but if you have an abatement policy, I don't see how you could start saying, this is okay, but because we have, you know, X, a duplicate over here, it's not okay. I don't see how that would work. So I would kind of disagree with that. But really, I think I'm concerned, too, with the vitality of the town. I'm concerned with jobs. I'm concerned with the tax structure. I don't like to see our property taxes go up, and I think that one way to do that is through proper development. Whether this is going to be a project that goes forward or not, I don't know. But at least I'm willing to look at it carefully, because those are important things. Offsetting taxes, jobs, construction jobs. I'm sure that some local people would be working in a project like this. So when I see it, I say, okay, I'm going to listen. We're going to continue to discuss this. And issues like education, the school system, when you look at the figures nationally, you look at the figures statewide, you see what the trends are. And population, school-age population growth is not really a concern of mine, based on what I've read. It could be to other people. I think we have, Connecticut's dead last, I believe, in terms of number of children under 10, and it keeps going down. It's just a fact, you know, that because of the economic climate, we don't have the growth, and we don't have the population growth, I think, that other parts of the country. Water and sewer, I happen to think that was a reasonable inclusion based on the fact that our water and sewer system is troubled. And if we have more money that and more customers and more revenue and more money, and that's all going to be new construction, it's going to be, you know, the from my understanding, that's the developer's responsibility. So the town, other than selling the customer more water and the fact that we're using the sewer, which is underutilized. These are assets we have that are underutilized, so that is a plus in my mind and not a negative. I don't think you looked at it as a negative. I think you were looking at it as a neutral kind of thing. And the other thing is that the icons, the three icons, historical buildings, you know, are certainly important to the community, are important to me, and I know many others. And there was some questions I did want to ask you. This is the one thing I had started out with. The concern about the fact that the construction phase, let's say this goes forward, and everybody, not everybody, but the majority of people think that whatever is negotiated is a reasonable and a good thing for the town. The buildings, the time frame with the buildings, I'm always concerned because I know Fred's a good guy, I'm sure you're a good guy, but as time goes on, you don't know what's going to happen to the plan, building X to be the Brainerd building. Okay, construction starts on the Brainerd building simultaneously with the other construction. How's that going to work so that people would feel comfortable that those projects would be completed as were stated?
You have the Sage House and the Brainerd House to be worked on at their existing locations. And so that simplifies some of the equation. The Hart Jarvis in being removed would be one of the first steps taken. So with the start of broad construction on the site, Hart Jarvis would be from where a lot of that needs to occur to his destination. Now, you then set it up and it would be there and it would look pretty, but we don't have a use, so we don't have all kinds of other things worked out that I think is a productive conversation that gets that dialogue next if we can work with the existing hurdles. In the tax agreement, there's nothing that keeps us from putting first apartment complex, for example, the 102 units, which is the exact same unit mix as Brookfield mix, that then, you know, an analogous data point because unit design does drive occupancy. By saying the Brainerd House has to be CO'd on the certificate of occupancy on the backside of the restoration in order to get 102 units. Those are the things that you typically sit down and put into the agreement.
Okay.
So that there's a deliverable that is known where, frankly, that engine doesn't start turning. It's not a leasable unit until you get this piece. And then over here, if there's a phasing plan that affects any of this dialogue, that would be the kind of thing that we would refine as we go. We certainly wouldn't get out of construction sequencing where we're fixing a building over here, doing massive construction all around it, right?
But the certificate of occupancy.
Yeah, the certificate of occupancy to the neighboring building, that would make very much sense for the Brainerd House, for example. Then Sage could be tied to the coffee shop or something, right? You could do it where you have a development plan and you just, I don't care what our perspective is, we all agree that some parameters like that would be part and parcel of it. Yeah.
Okay, that's all I have. Thank you.
Those are in the zoning regs. You're required to, 37,500 square feet of commercial has to be CO'd in order to build the residential units. I think it's spelled out.
Yeah, but it's, it manifests first in a permitting stage, but then the back side of it is what, you want to tie together nicely. And the comment, I think, was the gentleman who's commenting on the Brainerd carriage house and what he I absolutely get the dialogue there, but I think that there's, again, what's appropriate in this situation, there's enough scale to tie these things together and have the execution be painful if all the development players here are replaced by somebody else moving it ahead of us. We can make that part of the agreement.
Okay, it is 10 o'clock, and there were some people that asked to speak from Economic Development Commission. I'll ask the Selectmen if they want to entertain further discussion, or do you want to wait until we meet again on the 30th? We do have other business to conduct tonight. There's some practical matters here tonight, so I'll look to you for
direction. There's no objection to continuing, although I did want to ask a couple of questions for clarification. Mr. Butcher.
Okay. How do you feel?
I think they should be allowed to speak this evening.
Okay.
They waited.
Yeah, anybody who's here should speak. Yeah.
Mr. Bertram, do I understand that the reason for the tax subsidy essentially is to take care of these historical properties? Is that what I've heard this evening from you?
That is a component. There are other components.
And how much of a component is that?
I would say that I guess I can list the components.
Sure.
Right? It's these three structures. It's the podium approach on the apartment complex, which has material impact on the attractiveness of the entire site and development. There are secondary influences on saying, leave Brainerd there and move the entrance. That ripples into some other effects on Marlboro that need to be just worked out, and that's an additional investment. We talked about some of the risk-taking on the job in general and the absorption rates in a market that is very soft. And so that applies to commercial and residential. Greater runway, make the economic model prove out over time. Your part of the abatement is just to take that risk. A way to look at this, because Fred was talking about some data points that had come up in dialogue about, like, a Rocky Hill job, and they had done a 50% set aside. They were doing a 50% set aside just to get the developer to take the risk to build the project at all. They weren't then having another chunk of investment going into some valuable only to the community historic restoration, right? Because it doesn't have third-party value millions of dollars into these buildings, because if you're just talking about what you get out of the square footage of 2,200 square feet in our Jarvis house, that's not a valuable structure, but bringing it back to the 1800s is something that was deemed to be a collective good, and therefore we're just creatively figuring out how to do it. That's how I look at it.
And I read a quote that was attributed to you over the weekend. Do I understand that you were insistent that you need a 7-year tax abatement? You were quoted correctly?
I was quoted correctly. Okay. And my understanding was that the language that was to be refined in negotiation following the February 2015 process was there are many, these documents are not one page long, right? These things have terms on them and they get negotiated even outside the scope of economics. And so, frankly, that was all I was expecting was the next round of discussion. There are other things that we just talked about in terms of saying, how do we make sure those historic buildings
fair enough.
Is that right? Yep. Okay. We'll start with the back row over on this side.